So today let's make another episode of the solid state Tesla coil series, and today let's take a look at what experiment definitely not to do with a Tesla coil. People very often put various gas filled tubes to a Tesla coil to light them up remotely. It can wirelessly light up various fluorescent lamps and also tungsten lamps because they are argon filled, and various neon tubes, nixies, neon lamps and other gas filled tubes and bulbs. And this is all fine as long as the pressure inside of the tubes or bulbs is enough to basically clamp the voltage between the electrodes to a low enough level so it doesn't produce X-rays. Or basically the amount of gas molecules in it is enough so the electrons can never accelerate enough to produce X-rays when they hit something finally. But if the tube has a vacuum in it or a very low pressure, the electrons can be accelerated using high voltage to a very high speed, and then when they hit something, they produce X-rays as a byproduct. So it may be quite dangerous to put vacuum tubes or tubes with a very low pressure in them to a Tesla coil, because a Tesla coil produces a very high voltage. And of course it's a high frequency, high voltage, so it can be capacitively coupled. You don't even have to have two electrodes to apply a voltage in between. It can be just one electrode and basically a capacitive coupling. Or maybe even no electrodes. So those gas-filled ones are probably not that dangerous near a Tesla coil, but the ones with a vacuum or very low pressure are quite dangerous near a Tesla coil. It's definitely a very bad idea to put vacuum tubes to a Tesla coil, or even some tungsten lamps, small ones which have vacuum in them instead of argon. And also some discharge lamps have vacuum in the outer bulb. There is an inner tube in it filled with mercury or sodium or other gases. This is the case in, for example, sodium high pressure lamps or low pressure lamps, mercury vapor lamps or metal halide lamps. They have the inner gas-filled tube, but also an outer bulb for protection and thermal insulation, which is often under a vacuum. So those lamps near a Tesla coil could produce X-rays, as well as CRT tubes and other things with vacuum. Voltages like 10, 15 or 20 kilovolts are already enough to produce some X-rays. Of course, modern X-ray tubes have a heated cathode to emit the electrons and a very high vacuum, and the electrons go from the cathode to the anode, which has a very high voltage on it, and when they hit the anode, some of the energy is converted into X-rays and radiated. And this type of X-ray tube is called a Coolidge X-ray tube. But there is also a Crookes type X-ray tube, which is now obsolete, and it was used in the early days of X-ray machines. It has a cold cathode, which also emits electrons, and they also hit the anode. But because the cathode is not heated, they have to have some tiny amount of gas in them. They are not under a high vacuum. It's not a super high vacuum, it's a bit lower vacuum, so there is a little bit of atoms or molecules of gases to allow the emission of electrons, but not too many molecules of gases, basically not to slow down the electrons. And not to clamp the voltage between the electrodes. Because, for example, the pressure in a fluorescent tube is higher than this, and you can't apply a very high voltage to it because it basically clamps the voltage to just a couple hundred volts. And the amount of molecules of gases is too high, and the electrons have no space to accelerate to a very high speed. To produce X-rays, the electrons have to basically hit the anode at a super high speed. And to accelerate them, you need a very high voltage on the anode. And there were even some experimental X-ray tubes with just one electrode and capacitively coupled, powered by a Tesla coil probably, and they were used by Nikola Tesla. And they were connected to a high frequency, high voltage, and the anode was capacitively coupled, and the electrons basically hit it, and it was producing X-rays. This is also more or less what can accidentally happen when you play with a Tesla coil. When I was young and stupid, I tried to put a sodium lamp on the top of a Tesla coil, a solid state one. And the inner tube has some sodium in it and probably some mercury or noble gases for a startup, but the outer bulb for thermal insulation and protection is under a vacuum. And of course, what's inside of the inner tube doesn't really matter. Basically, the electrons are hitting the electrodes inside of the lamp from random directions, and it's also then emitting X-rays in random directions. And there is no heated cathode. It's quite unpredictable and random, because the electrons are not emitted from any particular place or source. There is a very low pressure probably in it, and there are some very low pressure discharges in it, which basically allow the electrons to move inside of it. And so in fact it was producing X-rays intermittently. Cold cathode X-ray tubes are quite unpredictable and random, and this is also the reason why Crookes X-ray tubes were later replaced by Coolidge X-ray tubes with a heated cathode. So now let's take a look at the video I recorded about 12 years ago, when I was quite stupid, and it was a horribly bad idea, and I would never repeat it, of course, and you also shouldn't do it. So that's the sodium lamp on a Tesla coil, and it looks like a mercury lamp because it's a retrofit for mercury vapor fixtures, basically. Most of other sodium lamps don't have a coated bulb. And I tried to measure it using this type of Geiger counter. This one is quite old, it's made in 63, and it has this probe, and I set it to the highest range, 100 millirengens per hour. And of course it maxed out. It was over range, and I have to say that it was probably over range by several orders of magnitude. It was quite a ridiculous idea to use this low-level radiation meter for X-rays. And on top of it, Geiger counters usually have a low sensitivity to low energy X-rays. But it maxed out anyway by probably several orders of magnitude. Of course, the dose rate from X-ray machines is usually much higher than people expect to make the amplifying screen glow. And the early X-ray machines were called fluoroscopes. They didn't have any film or digital sensor, they basically just had a screen that converted X-rays to a visible light, and you would see the X-ray shadow basically in real time. And of course there is a lot of DIYers which build X-ray machines in the fluoroscope style. But of course this is quite dangerous. There is a lot of it on the internet, and even more people who don't boast of it on the internet because nobody knows if it's legal. Nobody knows if there is any law prohibiting it. I actually tried it too about 11 years ago, and it's on my website and on my other channel. But I never put my body parts in it. I just controlled it from another room, from behind a very heavy wall. And of course I have recently seen the boys from the Kreosan channel playing with X-ray tube and some DIY high voltage generator, and they basically built a fluoroscope and they were putting their hands and legs into it. They were using some multiplier from a CRT television, and it could be something like 30, 40, 50, maybe 60 kilovolts, and the power like 5, 10, 20 watts maybe. And the fluoroscopic screen, which was actually an amplifying screen from an X-ray cassette, was about 30-40 centimeters from the X-ray tube. And in this distance the dose rate could have easily been something like hundreds or even thousands of rengens per hour. And this is just my wild guesstimate, just for you to know what kind of ballpark you're getting into. They measured it using a Geiger counter, and in about 3 meters they got multiple rengens per hour already, and the dose rate goes down with the second power of the distance. But of course because of the low sensitivity of Geiger counters to low energy X-rays, you could probably easily add another zero to those measurements. But I diverge. Let's take a look at the old video when I tried to measure my sodium lamp on a Tesla coil using the Geiger counter, the analog one. And of course it maxed out, which is absolutely not a surprise. But you could also see that it's quite intermittent, it does not radiate all the time. And then I did the notorious camera test. which you can also see in many other channels. I basically covered the lens of the camera using an aluminium foil, and basically the entire camera was covered in aluminium foil, and then I put it to the sodium lamp on the Tesla coil. And in the video from the camera you can see a lot of red, green and blue dots in the frame, as the high energy X-ray photons hit the CCD chip of the camera. But of course it doesn't fill the entire screen, because the solid state Tesla coil basically ran in just one half cycle. And because of the rolling shutter of the camera, it caught those dots in just some part of the screen. The rolling shutter basically scans the screen vertically like this. And of course the dotted stripe was moving up and down because the mains frequency is not divisible by the frame rate of the camera, or vice versa. The old camera was just 15 frames per second. And the camera was about 50, 60, 70, 80 centimeters from the sodium lamp. And the power input of the Tesla coil was about 500 watts. And of course with the amount of dots in the picture, the dose rate could have been easily also about hundreds or even thousands of rengens per hour. It was quite a bad idea. I would never do this experiment again, and I also don't recommend anybody to try this. It was about 12 years ago, and I'm quite glad I didn't have any health problems from this. And you've probably heard of the boy from Russia, from Moscow. He was building a fluoroscope and testing it on his fingers, and he suffered radiation burns on the fingers. X-rays are quite dangerous. A common sense can protect you from quite a lot of dangers, but a common sense unfortunately doesn't work for X-rays. You always tend to underestimate the risk, because it's a kind of danger that's not visible and not easy to understand using just the common sense. You have to have some knowledge to be able to work with it safely. And of course the link to the videos from the Kreosan channel where the boys play with X-rays is in the description. Those videos are quite interesting, but I wouldn't like to be anywhere near this. It's really super dodgy. About 11 years ago I did similar experiments, but I tested the machine just on objects, not on my body parts, and I was controlling it from behind a very thick wall and checking it for leakage. And even this feels a bit dodgy to me with a hindsight. I'm not going to repeat those experiments. It was enough. So this is Diagno Wild, and see you in my next videos, and thanks to all of my patrons on Patreon. I really appreciate your support. And of course I still plan to make a better secondary for my Tesla coil, a better top load. I also plan to choose better isolation pads and heatsink compound for my transistors, and I also plan to test a shorter dead time.